नमस्कार एवरीवन. नाउ आई सीक परमिशन ऑफ ऑनरेबल चेयरमैन ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर जीएम यूनिवर्सिटी टू स्टार्ट द प्रोसीडिंग ऑफ टुडेज लेक्चर. सर
परमिशन ग्रांटेड.
थैंक यू सर. गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द जीएम यूनिवर्सिटी आई उमाचरण पति डेप्यूटी रजिस्ट्रार वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू द 11th लेक्चर ऑफ द प्लैटिनम जुबली लेक्चर सीरीज. एस्टिम्ड वाइस चांसलर इन द चेयर, our honorable registrar Sri Girish Chandra Singh sir on the extreme left, all the heads of the department, chairman PG council, all the deans, all the faculty members, our warden and head of the department of Hindi, Dr. Paul sir, head of the department of commerce and controller of finance, Dr. Acharya sir, all the colleagues, students, media person, all the invited guests, retired teachers of the institution, and above all, our young speaker, chief guest of today's lecture, Sri Abhishek Karaji from Indore, Madhya Pradesh. I welcome all of you to this 11th lecture. We are sitting in the Amrita Vihar campus of the Gangadhar Mehr University, Sambalpur. Now, before we start the proceeding, let me tell you in brief about the Platinum Jubilee Lecture Series. The Gangadhar Mehr University, it came into being on 30th May 2015. So, as a university, we are just 5 years old. But as an institution, a glorious institution, we started in 1944 as the Sambalpur College. Then in 1949, we became GM College. Then in 1991, GM Autonomous College. And 2015, after a very good performance in the NET, we became Gangadhar Mehr University. So, as an institution, we have completed 75 glorious years in 2019. And now the institution has entered into the 77th years of its existence. Under the able leadership of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Atul Kumar Bhatti, we started the Platinum Jubilee celebration academically. More importantly, we started in an academic way in 2018, July 7. As a part of the process, our Vice Chancellor conceived the Platinum Jubilee Lecture Series. And as an original plan, we decided to have 12 lectures, Platinum Jubilee Lectures, by inviting very reputed persons, reputed speakers from across the country, belonging to different streams. Now, before the corona crisis sets in, we completed 9 lectures platinum under the banner of Platinum Jubilee Lecture Series in physical mode. And as you are aware of the crisis that we are moving through, we are just short of 3 lectures. But in the last week, we could conduct the 10th lecture where Madam Rita Malhotra joined. Today, we are in the midst of the 11th lecture, and one more lecture, the last one in the series of the Platinum Lectures, the Platinum Jubilee Lecture Series, is scheduled in the next week. And we are fortunate to have with us the chief speaker, Sri Abhishek Karaji, and he has joined from Indore, MP. He's a very young management coach, a motivational speaker, and he's going to enrich and empower our students and faculty today. So, being in the 11th lecture now, we have created two platforms. One is this Google Meet platform that we are in now, and for the wider circulation to all our students who can take the benefit of this lecture, we are also live streaming the entire proceeding of this particular lecture. And we are also recording the proceeding of this lecture. So now, before we start the actual proceeding of the 11th lecture, I request all of you to kindly stand up for our university anthem. And I request our system manager, Sri Ashish Kumar Patel, to please play the university anthem.
Sani sa ni ka sa ni pa ga ni sa ni sa. dekha madhu maya re jivana viswa dekha madhu maya viswa dekha madhu maya madhura charana hari bhavarana madhura charana hari bhavarana dukha pamarana maya re jivana viswa dekha madhu maya viswa dekha
Thank you, everyone. Now, in the next point of the agenda, we have the welcome address. Now, for the information of the attendees, let me tell you, Sri Abhishek Karji is an Odia Babat, but he is staying right now at Indore in Madhya Pradesh. So, what I mean to say is that ये उड़िया है लेकिन अभी ये इंदौर एमपी में रहते हैं वो हिंदी में जितना कंफर्टेबल है इंग्लिश में भी है उड़िया में भी है सो टू गिव दिस पर्टिकुलर लेक्चर ए ऑल इंडिया कैरेक्टर नाउ वी रिक्वेस्टेड आवर हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ हिंदी एंड आवर वॉरन सर आल्सो टू इंट्रोड्यूस आवर गेस्ट इन हिंदी बिकॉज वी हैव लॉट ऑफ नॉन उड़ियाज आल्सो जॉइंड दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रोग्राम सो एज अ मार्क ऑफ रेस्पेक्ट to our national language also. Now I request our head of the department Hindi, Dr. Sadan Kumar Paul ji, to please give the welcome address.
Honorable Vice Chancellor sir and Chairman of this event, Professor Atanu Kumar Pati, esteemed Chief Speaker of the occasion, Sri Abhishek Karji, respected Register of the University, Sri Girish Chandra Singh ji, respected Dr. Samacharan Acharya, Head of the School of Commerce, Deputy Register and Convener of this event, Dr. Umacharan Pati, all the respected persons who are with us in this virtual event, I, on behalf of Gangadhar![![================![================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================================ which is being held virtually due to the present pandemic situation. I am hopeful that today's topic will be helpful to build a strong and powerful mental attitude, which is always a need of the hour, especially in this present situation. I once again welcome all this occasion, the 11th Platinum Jubilee Lecture Series of GM University, Sambalpur, Gangadhar Mehta University, Sambalpur. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now I request our head of the Department of Commerce, Dr. Shyamacharan Acharya sir, to introduce our chief speaker to the audience. Sir.
Thank you, Dr. Pati. Honorable Vice Chancellor and Chairperson of today's online lecture program, Professor Atanu Kumar Pati, respected guest and today's resource person, Mr. Abhishek Kaur, esteemed Registrar and Deputy Registrar, esteemed heads of departments, colleagues, invitees, dear students and other participants of this online program. I deem it to be an honor to introduce today's guest, Mr. Abhishek Kaur, who is heading an asset management firm for high net worth individuals. By profession, he is a derivative fund manager, but his passion is to work as a business coach and corporate trainer. He has been imparting training in several multinational corporations and reputed educational institutions since last 8 years. He has been a proud recipient of 98 awards, the most remarkable among them being Young Leadership Award by GSK Group and Youth Inspiration Award by Purnwadi Group. These awards were conferred on him at the India's biggest bee farm hall, Mahatma Mandir, which is situated in Gandhinagar, the place where one of the government of India's most ambitious programs, Make in India, was launched. It will not be out of place to mention here about one of the most significant statements given by Mother Teresa, who has once said that one should not feel disappointed for failure as long as one is sure that one has tried one's best. In common parlance, it is understood that one meets failures due to lack of hard work and perseverance. Therefore, those who are hardworking, sincere, dedicated, and committed, nothing is impossible for them. What hard work and perseverance can do in the making of a successful individual who understand this, a concrete example and role model is present before us today, and he is none other than Mr. Abhishek Kaur. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your valuable time and sharing your knowledge and skill with the participants, especially our students. I shouldn't be a barrier between the participants and our speaker any longer. Let me end my address here. Thank you, sir. Thank you all once again.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Now, dear attendees, let me tell you the person who is responsible for all these academic programs in the JN University. Our leader, the person, the personality who is instrumental in transforming this institution, bringing vibrance to the campus academically, extra academically, and in administrative ways. Now we have progressed so far ahead. So now I request the person who has made us what we are today, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Atanu Kumar Pati sir, for his presidential address.
Good morning, all of you. At the outset, I congratulate the university administration for arranging this program. And today we have with us Honorable Chief Speaker, Sri Abhishek Ji, Abhishek Kaur Ji, with us. And believe me, I have seen him from his teenage, you know, when he was a school going student. And now he has grown to such a big height, you know. And he has been, you know, a very important motivational speaker in different spheres, in different organizations, corporate houses. And he is also advising on fund management and many other things, you know. I just cannot believe this because I have seen it. And I used to call him as Raja, you know. And he's Raja for me, not Abhishek Kaur. So This is a very important topic. I found that Kvarsar has chosen, that is the mental diet for champions. And you know, in biology, and we study the effect of diet, how it is controlling the brain. So that is a specialized neurons in the brain that is called hypothalamus. And in the hypothalamus, we have suprachiasmatic nuclei. And whenever you take food, and the time of the food and quality of the food, that gives signals to the suprachiasmatic nuclei, and then your bodily functions are regulated. That in technical language we call it as the central clock and the peripheral clocks. So there we have numerous clocks in our body, and we have a master clock or central clock in the brain, and that master clock regulates all the peripheral clocks. But sometimes what happens, in the absence of signal from the master clock, the peripheral clocks also operate autonomously. They're all independent clocks. But as long as messages are coming from the brain, they are slaves. They just take the directions of the master clock. So this slave and the master, that relationship is operating in our body, and that is the master clock and the slave clocks. And then physically whatever we take, food signals, time of food intake and the quality of the food, that determines how our metabolism is going to happen. But now the chapter he is going to deliberate upon, that's a different story. And this is that the diet for the champions, mental diet. So then this is very pretty interesting subject. So I hope that it will be quite illuminating. And we have around 300 plus audience. In this particular Google Meet platform, we have around 123. But we have another parallel channel where anyone can access, that is showing around 200 plus. So I believe that there are about 300 plus audience who will be listening to Sri Abhishek Karji. And I'll just add another very interesting thing, that his mother is an alumni of this great university, and she was a student of Gangadhar Mehr College. So then this link is also very important. That means you are addressing to the people of the institution where your mother studied. And then his father is a very close friend of mine. We work together at Banaras in the university while doing PhD. We are just working in the same lab, and we have very close association. And at the same time, I'll appreciate the presence of my registrar, Mr. Singh, and Deputy Registrar, Dr. Pati, and Dr. Acharya, and Dr. Sadanpal, all my colleagues, Dr. Naik, and everybody who is participating in this program. I say namaste to all of you. And now I think Dr. Kar will begin his lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So as sir said, besides the physical diet, we need to take care about mental diet that Sri Karji is going to talk about. So before he enters into his talk, let me introduce the topic by saying two things. One is a quotation from Emmett Fox. Now it says, "You must not under any pretense allow your mind to dwell on any thought that is not positive, constructive, optimistic and kind." The second thing is, I will take the help of one sloka from the Veda. Please bear with me, I'm not an expert in that line, but I think this will definitely throw lights on the topic that Sri Karji is going to take up. Now, two-liner, it says like this: Eka eva khago mani chiran jivatu chatakam miryat eva pipa sattu yachat eva purandaram. There is no other bird than the chataka, with greater self-esteem and pride. He drinks only rainwater and pleads only with Indra, the god of rain. He will never drink water from other sources like a pond or still water. This is what the sloka says. That means how self-esteem, pride, positivity, constructive thinking are important for our growth. This two-liner sloka talks about that. I am not an expert, but now we have got the opportunity to listen to our expert, Sri Abhishek Karji. So I welcome Sri Abhishek Karji for his lecture. Please.
Thank you so much. I hope everyone can hear me at this point of time. You can just write it down in the chat section in case all can hear me. Just type yes or something so that it's pretty evident for me that yes, all of you can listen to me.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So first of all, it fills my heart with great gratitude for the kind and joyous welcome you guys have actually offered me. I'm really thankful to Honorable Vice Chancellor and all the wonderful people who actually introduced me with such kind gesture. And thank you so much for even mentioning that, yes, my mother was actually a graduate from the same university, and also talking about my father. So it feels me more proud about these factors. And as rightly mentioned by one of our honorable speakers and professors that yes, although I was born and brought up in the place of Poha Jalebi, which we call as Indore, but I've got origins from Odisha. So first of all, Jai Jagannath to all the lovely audience out here. This is possibly the first time I'm actually delivering a session to entire, means I wouldn't say entire, but most of the Odia crowd over here. Before that, I've been invited into various institutions, call it IIT, IIM. I've been to North, I've been to Central India. I have delivered sessions into a lot of parts of Maharashtra, primarily Mumbai and Pune. But this is the first time when I'm getting this opportunity, gracing this occasion by spilling some words of wisdom for all my Odia family. So thank you so much. I believe I'll be able to add some value. Without any further ado, let's jump on with the topic. And guys, I'm very cognizant about this fact that most meaningful conversations have to be dialogues. So I know we are on an online platform, and to all intents and purposes, it's practically not possible to have a dual conversation because that will take a lot of time. But I would insist and humbly request you all to please participate in the chat section by typing yes and no on the open-ended questions I will raise. So is everyone ready with that? Just type yes if that's particularly fine, because that makes it more interactive. You will be able to take away a lot of things from this session, and that would make me feel good. Amazing, amazing. I can see a lot of yeses. Mr. Nayak, Tripathi ji, Mishra ji, Patel ji, Sarangi ji, Behra ji, Purohit ji, thank you so much. Thank you so much. So now, why did I choose this particular topic? The moment I received a call from Sir, why did I pick up this topic? Let me tell you this thing. We all have seen in the last 2-3 months, we have gained 2 types of weights because of staying within the vicinity of our residence and because of staying within our households. First, we have gained the physical weight. How many of you agree? How many of you can notice that, yes, they have gained some weight after staying in their houses? No need to be shy, because I feel most of them must have done, right? I can see a few yeses out there. So one is that physical weight, which almost everyone is talking about, okay? Everyone is talking. You go on YouTube, you will find a lot of people giving you a lot of generic knowledge about weight losing. You go to a lot of this thing, but I really want to add more weight. Okay, fantastic. We'll talk about few other stuffs. I think you have better people to talk about that. Next is something which we really talk about, and that is the mental weight which we have actually put upon during this period of COVID, during this period of lockdown. And strangely, a lot of people don't even talk about these things. I'm really astounded to see how many people have certainly developed suicidal tendencies in this period of time. You know, other day I was reading newspaper, a student just couldn't afford to attend the lectures on a cell phone, and that's why that student committed suicide. Now, you can just imagine the sort of mental weakness which is persisting in the youth these days. And it's not just with the youth, If you clearly observe, it's same with a lot of other people. I know there's an ongoing debate right now going on with the celebrity suicide. I'm not here to debate or give an unconventional note towards that conspiracy theory. But the point is, right now, we are into a grief movement where a lot of people are actually suffering either through anxiety or depression. And I believe, I firmly believe, most of you who are actually attending this session must be going through some sort of mental dilemma, mental skepticism when it comes to your profession, when it comes to your personal life, when it comes to a lot of other things. I can see a lot of people can agree to this part. So in this entire session, with my own experience, because let me make it crystal clear, I'm not here for the purpose of delivering a lecture, for I'm not a lecturer. What I've been doing for the last couple of years is I've been invited by organizations and corporates. I try to go there. I try to speak to the people. I try to connect with them. And I try to give solution based on practical example. Otherwise, don't you think it's so easy? If you want to feel motivated, just go on YouTube. Right now, it's on your fingertips. Search Sandeep Maheshwari. And for 2 hours, solid 2 hours, you'll be so damn motivated. And the next other moment, the moment you realize I've got my exams, again, that motivation goes down. And the number of people celebrating, absolutely. Absolutely. So Mr. Rajesh has also said that recently a doctor from AIIMS also got into the suicidal tendency and committed suicide. So that's a devastating state. So guys, why does this problem happen? I'll tell you. I would blame most of our society, most of our upbringing, because off and on, right from our schooling, the only aspect which we talk about is the biological aspect, the physical aspect, but rarely people are talking about the mental aspect. Rarely people are open enough to discuss about the mental pressures which one is actually going through. And my dear friend, there's a wonderful movie in Hindi which is named Three Idiots. I'm pretty sure a lot of you must have seen that. In case you haven't seen this, make sure you go and see. So there's a common dialogue by Aamir Khan where he says that these scientists and doctors and engineers are so clever. They found so many instruments to judge how the heart is performing, to understand the pressure on heart, but there is no significant instrument that can understand the pressure which you are having on your brains. And that's why probably why we actually need a lot of counselors, a lot of psychologists at this point of time. My dear friends, when I talk about champions, which is the topic for the day, you'd be surprised to know that they have a pattern. They form a particular form of mental diet which they are consuming. And that is completely different from what we are consuming. All we are actually bothered about how our body is actually functioning. But my dear friend, if your brain isn't functioning well, believe me, your productivity will go out for a toss. You won't be able to perform at your peak performance. And moreover, you won't be able to attain your goal. So now tell me everyone, I'm just going to throw these questions like a dart at all of you. How many of you, listen carefully, how many of you really, really, really want to achieve remarkable results in your life? Just type I. How many of you really want to achieve remarkable results? Fantastic. The next one. How many of you really want to become the best version of yourself, irrespective of whatever profession you choose to? Just type I. Come on, let's not be lazy. Okay, I can see a lot of people participating out here. I expect others also to equally participate over here because this will keep you engaged. Fantastic, fantastic. And final question. I can understand there are a lot of issues, Mishraji, but we are going to cover this thing. Don't worry. And final question. How many of you really want to spend their life at peace? Because I feel the ultimate goal of each one of us to stay in a peaceful life, right? Peaceful environment, fantastic. So today's session in a nutshell is going to cover all those people who are saying I at this point of time. I'm really humbled to understand that so many people really want to get into these things. So I've got a presentation also aside over here where I'm going to cover a few champions. And I'm going to now present the screen at this point of time. I hope you guys will understand this thing. So now I'm going to put the screen on this. Okay. Can everyone see the screen at this point of time? Just let me know if you can see the screen, everyone. Everyone can see the screen. Okay, fantastic. So now for the next couple of minutes, I'll be actually talking about I think it's visible, right? Okay. Thank you so much. So I'm going to talk about a few champions from various fields, and we're going to understand what exactly these people are putting into their brains, these tiny brain cells, what these people actually put, which is making them incredibly successful. Okay, the first one over here, how many of you can guess who this guy is? You know, the reason why I'm actually starting with this person is because a lot of people don't know about him, but he has actually achieved great amounts of success in his life. Everyone can see the screen, right? Everyone can see the presentation. Am I correct? I believe everyone can see the presentation.
Okay.
So for those people who don't know who this person is, this is legendary investor, the great Warren Buffett. Now, why do I mention about this person? See, whatever you sow, you're going to reap. This is something which is written in a brief into our holy scriptures. It is written in Gita. It is written in Bible. And same has been applied by all the champions across their forte, across their profession, across whatever endeavors they've actually embarked upon. So this great gentleman, Mr. Warren Buffett, you'll be surprised to know his current age is 89. And I'm not here to promote capitalism just because I'm a fund manager. That's not my purpose. We are here to learn something out of each of these champions. Now, do you know how much reading he used to do for the past 30 years? You'll be astounded to know, not just 30, even before that he used to read more. Every day he used to read 300 pages. My dear friends, 300 pages every day. You can just imagine what amount of knowledge he was putting into his brain. Now, it sounds quite obvious. He's not a professor, okay? He's not a teacher. But then why is he reading? That's one big mistake which most of us actually do. The moment we graduate out of your universities, just ask yourself how many books which are out of your syllabus have you read in the last 12 months? The fact is, an average CEO, we always aspire to look upon people who have achieved great successes in their lives, but we don't realize that an average CEO reads 54 books in a year. That accounts to almost one book in a week. Ask yourself, just be honest, how many of you have read even 10 books in this year? Just be honest, I just want to see the answers at this point of time. How many of you have read at least 10 books in this year? Just be honest, yes or no? If you haven't read, you can actually type no. If you have read, you can actually type yes. See. We are ready to feed our minds with a trailer of Bahubali. We are ready to play in our minds what is happening with the trailer of Sadak 2. But strangely, we are not ready to encourage our people to enrich their minds. That's one problem. And it's not just with Warren Buffett. Elon Musk, he's a great entrepreneur. He runs 6 companies. He runs a company based on solar system. He runs Tesla Motors, which is an automobile company. Elon, yes, Elon is great. Absolutely, Joshiji. So he is actually running 5 to 6 companies at this point of time. And do you know, his company SpaceX, he launched his first rocket in his lifetime by merely reading books. He started reading at the age of 12. He used to sit in the library constantly reading. And can you just imagine, in a place where we feel that rockets cannot be made until and unless... Is my audio clear, guys? I hope my audio is clear. I just want to make sure the audio is clear and everyone can... Okay, fine. Okay. Most of it is clear. Some people might be facing because of the network issues at their end. So please do work upon that. So coming back to the point, Elon Musk. So he formed rockets by merely reading books, in a place where we feel that until unless we have a lot of progressive thoughts, we have a great team, we have, and yes, he's a self-taught rocket scientist. Here's an interesting story. In 2008, we all know the world was hit with crisis, recession. Now just imagine, okay, tell me how many of you, if I actually give you $200 million, now don't go and calculate in your head. Let's say if I give you $200 million, what do you think? And suppose I say you have to retire. How many of you will actually retire at this point of time? Just tell me, how many of you will actually feel that, okay, that's a good amount of money. It's time that I should retire. Just type I, just be honest. How many of you would actually try to do that? Lol, I will. Tanmayji is saying that he would. Anyone else? I? Okay. That's literally enough for me. Okay. Now, here's an interesting piece of story. Just listen to it. And this is a real story. Later on, you can actually Google and find on YouTube. In 2008, his companies were going under the hammer because his entire company was at risk. It was a recession. He had $200 million in his account because he was the one who started PayPal. So he has previous history of developing a lot of, today we see this e-payment system. Mishraji, somewhere there could be some issue. I hope, please don't mind. Okay, I'll come to the topic. So he actually was asked by his investors that now the company is going into the drain. What will you do? You know what he did? He actually put up his entire $200 million, his personal net worth onto stake to save his companies, saying that whatever may happen, I'm extremely passionate about these things. And at any cost, I'm going to save this company. And he literally did this thing. And today, Tesla Motors, as you all know, while I'm speaking, is one of the most renowned companies. Now, in the hindsight, it looks so good, so inspiring. But can you just imagine at a stage where your entire company is going out in a drain and you are giving an option that you have to leave this thing, but you still don't leave it? Now, can you just imagine why he did so? One is obviously passion, but there is another reason. Another reason is because the mental diet he always had into his brain always said that if you are actually having optimistic thoughts, if you are having a lot of passion, you can completely defy what the naysayers are saying and you can do something which is completely impossible. Yes, absolutely, Mishraji, you're completely right. I know pretty much sure a lot of people must be checking Google at this point of time. So same goes with Warren Buffett. So the first mental diet, which I want all of you to promise, is from today itself, you all will start reading at least 5 pages a day of something motivational, something related to your subject, but not the syllabus book, but something which can be enriching. How many of you can promise that you're going to do this thing? Just type P. In case promise is a big word, just type P on the chat section. So that it's evident for me that yes, you are getting the right message. So first of all, and youngsters, believe me, it was a reading habit which actually turned the tables for me. There was a point of time when I was left with just $500 in my pocket, and it was reading habit which helped me to come and change that entire space. Next one, I'm pretty sure a lot of people must not be knowing who this person is. I'll tell you, he's David Goggins. Now I know that a lot of you are from science background. And scientifically, if I say that someone can reduce 50 kgs of weight in 2 months, I think that is defying science. It would be unhealthy as per them. And a lot of people would say, no, come on, that's actually not the right approach to go with this thing. Now, this guy, now look at his mental habit and mental diet. He wanted to be part of Navy SEAL. Okay, he wanted to be a part of Navy SEAL and Air Force, I believe. Air Force or SEAL, I believe. And SEAL training is very tough. At that point of time, he was weighing close to 130 kgs or 140, something like that. Because his height was 6'1". So he was a heighted person, but had a lot of weight. Now tell me, will someone enroll such heavy-weighted person into army? Yes or no? Just tell me by wild logic. Will someone actually take certain person who is so overweight into army? His height is good, no doubt about it. But of course, no one is going to take it. Now, here's what he did. One was to give up on his dreams. That was number one solution. Second one was to feed his mind with ultra positivity and something called affirmations. Today, when you read a lot of self-help books, it has been completely commercialized, the concept of affirmations. I'm quite surprised to see a lot of people actually sell this affirmation technique. But with free of cost, I'm going to tell you what exactly you need to do. Plain and simple, whenever you're actually facing some big challenge in your life, you're facing health issues in your life, you're facing something really devastating, instead of focusing in a loop format that, oh my God, I'm ill. Oh my God, I'm going to face these problems. I'm going to, you know, completely die out of this issue. Instead of that, start affirming yourself again and again. No, I'm the best. No matter what happens, I'm going to achieve these goals. No matter what the world says, no matter what the naysayers say behind my back, I am going to achieve this goal. And believe me, guys, this is not something theoretical. This has been proven by scientific research, which was done in California, where they actually tried it on athletes. And they realized the athletes who actually practice these affirmative techniques are actually performing well and they have highest amount of achieving their goals. So next time whenever you're going to sleep or the moment you wake up or you take a web project, instead of being scared that, oh my God, I've got so much of competition, I cannot sustain to a business, I cannot be a good researcher, I cannot be a good teacher, instead of thinking all these things, just affirm that no matter what happens, I am going to attain the highest possible results, which is possible. To quote, there's a person called Walt Disney. We all know today his byproduct, Disney. Just imagine if your loan gets rejected for 309 times. Yes, not once, not twice, not thrice. 309 times his loan projections, his loan proposals were rejected, but he kept reminding himself, affirming himself, no matter what happens, I'm not going to give up. And he kept on affirming, and 310th time for his wonderful Disneyland. Today, everyone goes to abroad. They make it a point to attend the various carnivals which happen over there. And today, that's a prestigious thing. So how many of you promise, just type P, that from now onwards, you're going to reduce the limiting beliefs and going to always tell yourself, no matter. So before exams, you have to affirm, no matter how tough the paper might be, I'm going to excel because I have studied. Of course, it has to be action oriented. You can't just sit around the television and think, no matter how the paper would be, I will pass. That won't happen. But if you worked hard towards preparation of your paper, make sure you keep on affirming yourself, no matter how hard the papers are being set by my professors, I am going to crack it. And that itself makes a lot of difference. So this guy from 150 plus weight came down slowly to this shape. No one can tell that at some point of time, Mr. David Goggins was so fat. Today he has got six pack abs. He has been training a lot of people. He's the strongest man alive at this point of time. And just imagine. So the second mental diet, first was reading. Second is affirmation. Keep on affirming yourself. Now the third one. How many of you have heard of Usain Bolt? Just type yes. How many of you have heard of this person called Usain Bolt? The fastest runner, sprinter, inspiring. Now, there was a slow story. I'm just going to tell you this thing before I come to Mr. Usain Bolt. So Wipro's Azim Premji, Wipro's founder, this is a multinational giant at this point of time, an IT company. I had the privilege of training some people out there as well. So once Wipro was established, an interviewer actually asked the great Azim Premji that, sir, what made you such overnight sensation? And did you know what he answered? He answered, it took me 15 years of 24/7 work without taking any off on Saturdays and Sundays to become this overnight sensation. My dear friends, for those people who feel that why do we need to work on Saturdays? Why do we not need to work on Sundays? We can just relax. This is something which has been, no doubt, if you're getting burnt out, you need some sort of rest. But that doesn't mean it should become an excuse. Because if you are resting and then you say that I'm going to watch a lot of Hollywood movies, you are practically not resting. Because your mental diet is actually going wrong. How? Because you're consuming a lot of crap. Don't you think that sometimes you watch some movies, you feel so drained out. But when you watch motivational movies or inspirational ones, for example, how many of you feel pumped up when you see movies like Marie Kondo, when you see The Pursuit of Happiness, when you see Three Idiots, when you see Chak De India, how many of you feel pumped up that yes, I really need to? How many of you feel pumped up when you see even some Odia inspirational movie? You must be feeling, wow, that's so great, that's so exciting, right? So how many of you promise now that no doubt you're going to keep a balance, but you're not going to watch a lot of crap stuffs? That is not going to gain any productivity because you're feeding. You have a tiny brain. Come on. Our brain is very small, right? But then it is going to feed. If you're going to feed a lot of crap into your brain, you won't have enough space to think upon innovative ideas, creative ideas, and a lot of other things. So that's another point which you have to make sure that you're watching. For instance, every morning, this is something which I particularly do. Every morning I listen to podcasts. A lot of people may not be aware of this subject also. That what is podcast or something, but then podcasts are radio format of understanding a lot of valuable lessons. So I use my Spotify. I've got the premium version. I don't mind paying these people as long as I'm getting effective things. So if you don't want podcasts, you can listen to some motivational YouTube videos. You can watch something motivational because this indeed is going to help into your growth. So let me give you an example who has done this thing in past. How many of you know who this person is? Can you see the screen? In case you can see the screen, how many of you know who this person is? Can somebody tell me? It's so interesting. We are always availing the services of these people, but we don't know. Yes or no? How many of you people know? If you know, yes, type yes. If you don't know, just type no. How many of you actually know who this person is? No? No? Okay. Let me throw this question. How many of you know McDonald's? How many of you ever had this privilege of eating that food from a McDonald's, a burger or this thing? So this is the guy who's behind the revolution of this great giant McDonald's. Okay. Now, it's quite interesting when I see my relatives, in fact, sometimes my parents also, saying that now we are getting old, it's time that we retire and all those things. Now, here's an interesting part. This person right now over your screen started his journey at the age of 55. Yes, my dear friends, at the age of 55. The owner of KFC actually started, yes. And the real, if you talk about KFC, the KFC brand was started at the age of 66. What does that mean? That means that in our entire life, mentally, we have been feeding our brains with limiting thoughts, which have been passed on with the society. And we actually need to come out of this thing. It's more like we are a programmed system. And right from our inception, that is our birth, we have been kept into cubicles. For example, once you are born, you are kept into a tiny 4x4 cubicle where they actually swing you out. The moment you grow up, there is another cubicle called school. You're not permitted to think anything out of the box at that point of time. Then there is a bigger cubicle. I wouldn't say because universities like this are encouraging now people to have these sessions. But earlier, we all will agree, universities were not encouraging these kind of sessions. So again, there was a cubicle. After that, you go for a job, again confined to a cubicle. And at the end, there is something called coffin. More like a cubicle. So we always have got the limiting factor. And that's one of the reasons why 95% of the people actually don't attain their maximum potential in their life, because those 95% of the people are doing exactly what other 95% people are doing. If you want to achieve what rest 5% people are doing, you have to stop thinking of the society at some point of time. You have to stop thinking of what your relatives are going to again and again going to talk about, because they have been born into that limiting mindset. You have to think out of the box. You have to think beyond the boundaries, and only then you will be able to survive. Just imagine if Elon Musk was born in India and $200 million, if he would have said, I'm going to put entire stake on my company, just imagine what his father and mother would have said. Arre nahi beta, please don't do this. 50% to apne paas rakh le and then invest other things. This is practically what people do. But no, he actually stopped thinking from the limiting factor. I'm not advocating the fact that what he did was extremely correct, but that was the sort of passion and inclination and his faith on his program that he didn't listen to anyone. How many of you agree that somewhere or the things we are taking from the society and the mental perspective are actually stopping us from achieving our goals? How many of you agree with this thing? It could be students, it could be faculty members out here. How many of you feel that yes, right from our beginning, we have been sowed with so many seeds of limiting belief, and our limiting belief is so small. I know this might sound very pragmatic when speaking on an Indian front, but believe me, people in Mumbai and Delhi have actually started adopting this thinking, and it's high time nationally we should accept. For example, in India, there is a simple culture. The person is born, then the parents actually bluff that all you need to do is study till 10th. That's it. After that, enjoy. After 10th, they again bluff. All you need to do is study till 12th. Again, they bluff. All you need to do is graduation. And again, after that, all you need to do a job. Then you get married. And then the story is completely different. The point I want to make over here, there's nothing wrong in case these are your priorities. But you should always think you should always set your priorities first before getting into this conventional mode. So how many of you promise, just type P, that from now onwards, you will have an outward thinking from today? Because otherwise, all these things you are listening at this point of time will be like 5-minute motivation, and then everything goes haywire. And this is something which I particularly practice myself. Of course, I do get sometimes I argue with my father as well on this topic, but then he has his point of view, I have my point of view, we keep it open discussion, and finally we come to a conclusion. So everyone, fantastic. Now I'll quickly come to the concept of 3C, our mental habit. Consciously, you have to make it a point that you are not getting consumed by these three things, because whatever you consume, you become. So these are the three things, the 3C. Keep an outcome-oriented schedule. I can understand, Mishra ji, but then you have to, it all depends how badly you want it. Plain and simple. If you badly need a goal, then you're going to do whatever it is needed. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, the great missile man, you know, I'm not giving an American example now, Indian example. He was born in a poverty-stricken place. Under no circumstances his villagers were educated, the one whom with he used to stay. And can you imagine from where he actually went to what direction? He actually became Missile Man of India. There's this tiny story, just because you raised this thing. Can you just imagine the first time when he was actually invited to be acknowledged, to be given the Padma Shri Award? He didn't have a good pair of shoes and he didn't even have a good pair of jacket to go and receive this thing. As a consequence, what he did is, another important aspect, just listen carefully. Another important aspect, he always had a tiny friend circle who were positive, who were helping out, and they suggested that, you know, Mr. Kalam. Mr. Kalam said, can you please help me out to get a coat and a pair of shoes to attend this session? His friend, just imagine how good his friend was. His friend told him, dear Kalam, the coat or the suit is not what you're wearing. What you're wearing at this point of time is your character, and people love you for your character, not what you wear upon these things. So just imagine, in your, when you talk about mental diet, when you talk about all these things, even your circle becomes very important. There are four core things which actually define your mental diet. First, what you read. So we talked about, you have to read something good. You have to read about, instead of reading always about the murders, the conspiracy theories, all these things. Okay, a part of it is fine, but it should not consume you. You should read something which is related to your topic, related to your subject. So what you read is the first thing of your mental diet. What you listen. In listening, we have heard Gandhiji saying, "Bura na bolo, bura na suno, bura na kaho." So this also applies over here. You have to listen to motivational things. If not motivational, something related to business. If not business, something related to science. Tell me one thing, what substantial impact so far you have actually made in your life if you have seen 100 movies in 30 days? Have you heard any successful person saying that I've seen 100 movies in 30 days and I've become extremely successful? Is there anyone who has heard this thing? Let me know this thing. Have you ever heard someone saying that, you know, I've watched 100 Bollywood movies in 30 days and I've become extremely successful? No. Tell me one single person other than journalist who has told that I have watched news almost entire my life and I've become extremely successful. Can you name one single person who has done this thing? No. So what I'm saying is, try to keep a balance. I'm not saying completely devoid. After all, we are human beings. We're emotional people. We need to consume these things, but we have to prioritize. So second, what you listen. So if 80% of the time, this is a striking revelation which was made by a scientific study which said that in a day, we get 60,000 thoughts, of which 80% are negative. On a forefront, it looks scary. But then it's our responsibility. No one is going to come and feed. You guys are matured enough to understand that we deliberately need to replace all the negative thoughts with positive thoughts. So the next moment you feel like, oh my God, that person betrayed me, you have to subconsciously practice, because practice makes a man perfect. Only then this will become a habit. You have to practice, no matter what others are saying about me, I will be focused upon my goal. Because I'll tell you one simple analogy through which you will understand. Okay. I'm giving you two situations. Everyone listen carefully. Okay. I'm giving you two situations. Let's say you're a climber who loves to, you know, go up on a mountain. Let's say you're a climber and somehow you're able to climb this thing without any bag or something. So situation one, you climb a mountain without a bag. And situation two, I give you that climber will actually have a 50 kg of weight on his back and then he needs to climb. Whom do you think will climb the mountain faster and reach the goal faster? First or second? First or second? Who will reach the goals faster? Khushbu says first. What about others? Aishwarya says first, Shibani says first. Come on, everyone. Kalyani says first, the one with the less weight. Of course, Rajesh ji. Okay, Shikha says, Akansha says first. Okay, now let's convert this analogy. You all want to achieve something great in your life. You want to achieve some great things in your life, but always you are keeping a lot of mental weight. Oh my God, I have to take revenge. Oh my God, I have to do this thing. Oh my God, I have to, you know, speak something against this person. Aren't you putting yourself mentally down. The weight is pulling you down, and that's why your distance from your goal is going far and far, and it would be too late before you realize that what sort of mistake you have done. Practically, I've experienced, because I was into a situation where I used to drag into all these conflicts. But now, thankfully, because of reading, because of meeting a lot of successful people, I realized that all these things in the 10 years duration of time is completely useless if I'm keeping a lot of revengeful thing. So 3 C's remains is complaining. If you're always having a complaining mindset, criticizing, always having a criticizing. And 3rd is comparing. If you're constant state of comparing your progress with others, believe me, I can give you in writing, you will never ever succeed. If at that point of time Elon Musk have thought that, oh my god, there's so many businesses, I should change my business route by comparing himself with Bill Gates or someone, he wouldn't have reached at this place. If Dhirubhai Ambani would have thought that, oh my god, there's so much of competition, I'm not even educated. For those people who feel that he is extremely educated, the late Dhirubhai Ambani was actually a dropout. He wasn't that much educated. And just imagine, he, in his entire life, he raised a company called Reliance with $75 billion of net worth in his entire life. So if he would have thought, because his father was a teacher and he always said, play safe, you don't need to take a risk. If he would have thought of all these things, he would have never progressed to build such giant Reliance. 3rd, if he would have started comparing that, oh my God, Tatas are out there, how can I become big? He wouldn't have it. So promise me, everyone, promise me that you will try your best. I know instantly it's not possible, but at least we can build up this habit. 1% each day, in 100 days, you will reach 100%. So how many of you promise that you will slowly reduce your feelings of complaining, comparing, and criticizing? How many of you agree with these things? Because believe me, these are choti choti magar moti baate, we don't realize. These are the ones which are stopping from our goal, and then we complain, oh my God, why I am not receiving the goals. Plain and simple. How many times have you seen Mukesh Ambani coming on the television, because he is often interviewed, saying bad about, oh, Ratan Tata is so bad, and this Bill Gates is so bad? You would never listen to him. How many times Bill Gates, you have seen, initially he used to do this thing, but as you matured, he also realized. How many times you have seen Bill Gates saying, Google is such a bad company, Warren Buffett is such a bad company? You would never seen. In fact, sometimes if you observe Donald Trump, he would speak words like, oh my God, I'm working in a fabulous business, this is fantastic, and all those things. Have you ever seen successful people who have reached pinnacle in their success, in their respective profession, speaking so ugly? Even if they know, they realize that, okay, this person is bringing something bad upon me, they make themselves mentally so robust that no one can actually stop them. And this is something which I've not studied with one or two people. There's a wonderful book which I'll recommend all of you, Think and Grow Rich, published in the year 1940 by Napoleon Hill. Having interviewed more than 300 successful people, including hundreds of scientists, hundreds of businessmen like Ford, Einstein, Edison, he has interviewed all these people, and he bought all these compilation, saying these are the common factors which are common amongst all these people. They don't complain, they don't criticize, they don't, and they are only and only focused on this thing, because these mental habits, these diets which you're putting into your brain, are completely going to ruin your life. So how many of you promise, just type P, how many of you promise that yes, you're going to make sure that you are not going to put these things? Fantastic. I can see the sort of spark right now emerging into your brains at this point of time. Again, there's another concept, solution based. So someone, I think so, Mishraji or someone actually asked. So there's a concept called HALT. And this is something which you consciously need to understand. So as the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Mr. Dr. Pathy, actually talked about the biological aspect of health and the mental health, I'm going to talk about, because he's an expert in that field. So with due respect, I cannot speak so much about that relevant topic. But I'm going to tell you something. There's a concept called HALT, which you should actually follow. I follow in my life. And this is something you consciously need to understand. So H stands for hunger. If you are feeling hungry, okay, I'm talking about the food part only. If you're feeling a lot of hunger, A stands for angry. If you're feeling a lot angry upon something or a topic or something, if you stay, the L stands for lonely. If you're feeling a lot lonely, specifically in this COVID time, you feel a lot of loneliness. And finally, the T, and this T stands for, so you are hungry, lonely, angry. And if you're feeling a lot of terrified, because of some consequences, if you're thinking, if you're getting anxious that, oh my God, what could be the consequence? Then you need to understand, you need to stop yourself. You're probably having a bad mental diet. So what you need to do is, if you're feeling hungry, you would often feel devastating. You will often feel really bad. Quickly, you can actually consume something which is rich in protein or which has got some sort of sugar. I'm not saying complete sugar, but some sort of sugar. You need to consume, because that is again going to send some good signals to your brain. You'll feel active. If you're feeling angry, you just think, you just ask yourself again and again, after 10 years, will this really affect my life? Will this be helpful in making me peaceful? If the answer within you comes as no, then my dear friend, there is no point of holding on to this anger. Because I always say, there's a famous anger is like grasping a hot coal with the intent of throwing it on someone else. And believe me, you are the one who gets burnt. It's not the other person. The other person is relaxing, sleeping, doing whatever he wants to do. So how many of you need to, you all need to wire your brain into this format. The moment you feel angry, after you have attained your consciousness, ask yourself that, is it going to really help me out in the next 10 years? If not, then I'm wasting my time. I'm putting something really bad in my brain. Next, lonely. In this COVID time, we all felt lonely. How many of you observed specifically in your families, there were comparatively more conflicts happening with your family members as contrast to when there was no lockdown? How many of you observed this thing? It could be with your spouse. It could be with your daughter. It could be with your son. It could be with your father. How many of you observed that during this COVID thing, loneliness, because we all are confined into our houses, we had more amount of fights and arguments with our parents? Just type yes or I that yes, you did observe this thing particularly happening at this point of time. How many of you observed this thing? I'm pretty sure a lot of you must have. Absolutely. Riya ji says, Pratinanda ji says that yes, they observed this thing. Kalyani ji. So you need to understand one thing, that yes, this loneliness, somehow you have to come out of it. How you can come? Maybe you keep on constantly interacting with someone on phone. Okay, that's fantastic. Mishra ji, that's fantastic. But in a lot of houses, it was seen that being lonely can, for an extended period of time, can cause all these chemical reactions into your brain, ultimately leading to all these things. Another thing you need to understand is the final thing. If you're terrified, let's say you set a big goal and you get terrified that, oh my God, how am I going to achieve these things? Do you know, scientists have actually found that 85% of the anxiety feelings come when we are trying to predict our future. And 85% of these things actually don't even happen. We are simply nervous that something will actually happen in the future, which rarely happens. And 25% of the times when these things actually take place, the effects are so mild that you can easily tackle over this. So we unnecessarily stress ourselves thinking upon what is going to happen, what is going to happen, how I'm going to tackle all these things. And this makes the things very devastating. So just like the doctors say that you should avoid the three C's, the three S, that is sugar, salt, and stress. Likewise, you should avoid the three C, complaining, comparing, and criticizing. How many of you agree this can actually be a game changer? Yes or no? How many of you agree? Just type yes, that this could be a game changer. Fantastic, fantastic. That's amazing. That's amazing. That's amazing. Now, quickly, in the next 2 minutes, 2 to 5 minutes, I'm going to tell you about a few techniques. How many of you are excited? Just type yes. A few techniques, practical techniques, which a lot of people have been doing this thing. And that can certainly shift your focus. You can feel good, scientifically proven. A lot of researches have taken place, and entrepreneurs, scientists all have performed this thing. So the first is a Japanese technique. I'm truly influenced by a lot of the Japanese culture because of the hardworking, their capacity, the way they actually work out. You need to understand there's a Japanese technique called the six breath technique. What does that mean? That simply means that when you suddenly consciously understand you're feeling a lot stressed out, when you feel you're getting a lot angry, thank you so much, Patiji, for calling this thing a fabulous thing. Coming back to the topic, when you feel a lot stressed, when you feel a lot anxious, all you need to do is take a pause, just recall what I said over here, and take 6 deep breaths. Remember Patanjali Yoga, something which was derived from our own country, that is India. There also we have talked about this particular subject. And this is something which you all particularly need to follow. So whenever, so let's say I get a lot of business projects. So as mentioned, I've been a fund manager, and managing almost $3 million of client funds is not an easy task. You can understand when you're managing someone else's funds, that's very stressful, specifically with volatile markets we have and the stock markets we have. In that sort of situation, what exactly I do is when I feel, yes, Ikigai, that's a wonderful book. I've recently ordered that, Majiji. In fact, I'm going to read that book today itself. Thank you so much for reminding me of that book. I just ordered it from Amazon. So you have to take 6 deep breath whenever you feel tensed, when you feel anxious, and that is automatically going to reduce the sort of pain you're going to have in your mind. So first, 6 deep breathing. Next thing which you really need to do is you got to follow a diet plan, which now I'm going to tell you. As we understood by this entire session, that what you read, what you watch, what you listen, and what you talk about is certainly going to form your mental diet. You have to consciously make a promise to yourself that from today, you're going to read good stuffs rather than reading all the crap. Because this world, this with the advent of technology, we have 95% of the ecosystem feeding us with negative things. Open newspaper, tell me how many times you see positive news. Do you see this scientist received so many awards, this entrepreneur is doing so much good? No. On the contrary, 95% of the newspapers are filled with murders, someone went into pilgrimage and then died, then heart attack, cancer, and all these things. So first is consciously, this is something which Bill Gates was asked into an interview. He simply said that one of the basic reasons is because I care a fig of what is happening into the world at that point of time. When I'm focused on my goals, I don't look into the news channels. Yes, it's flooded with negativities. So that's number one. And this is something which I'm not saying. This is something which has been proven by these legends in their fields. That's number one. Second, just I mentioned what you watch. So do watch action movies. I'm not saying you should completely get devoid. After all, you're human beings. We want to enjoy our life. So it's practically impossible if we completely stop watching all these things. So you need to watch all these things, but keep your ratio of watching positive things more as compared to negative. Watch something inspirational. My suggestion would be watch something like TED Talks, Josh Talks, where you get to understand that people like you and me, who are actually not from rich family, actually turned their tables. People like you and me, who are not from a very big family, certainly went on and became great academicians. For example, even my father is coming from a village area where they were devoid of a lot of normal resources. And proudly, he became, because he used to read all those things who could build him his focus into a good scientist. Lately, he has been reading different stuff, which I don't encourage. But he used to read all those things which could build up his progression, which could build him into a good scientist, and see, out of his own village, he was probably one of those people. And that is one of the reasons why I'm sitting in front of all of you people, because I got such kind of grooming that I could deliver this kind of session. So you need to understand this thing. Third is what you listen. This is something in particular which my mom has been following lately. So how many of you know about this organization which says Om Shanti? How many of you know about this thing? Brahma Kumaris, how many of you know about this thing? Have you heard about this thing? Yes, 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 yes. Okay. So here's something interesting. My mom, Brahma Kumariji. Yes, absolutely. With due respect to Brahma Kumariji. So my mom has made it a habit for the last 1 year that every morning she listens to them. Even before she starts her day, she's actually listening to Gayatri Mantra. Ever thought why our ancestors, because initially, when I was young, even I didn't think why all these, you know, old people keep on insisting us to listen to Gayatri Mantra and all those things in the morning. I'm just being honest. But now I do realize, because these things carry positivity. The way you start your day actually defines how your entire day is going to progress. If you're going to start your day with hard rock metal music, that is completely going to ruin your life. If you're going to start your day by reading murders, rapes and all those things, that is going to ruin your day. You have to start with something positive. And that is something specific my mom has been following. I wouldn't say she has completely transformed, but yes, there has been 60% changes over a duration of 1 year, which I think is incredible. So a disclaimer, I'm not promoting any organization. I'm not a part of any organization. What I am trying to say is just listen to something good, something vibrating, something positive, because what you feed, it's plain and simple. If you are going to sow the seeds of a tomato, you are not going to get pumpkin. Likewise, if you're going to sow the seeds of negativity, you are not going to get positive outcome. Okay, what is the right time to start a day? See, practically I start my day as early as 5 o'clock in the morning, but it depends on other people. Some people are actually night owls. They work at the highest frequency at the night time, but it's very important that you have to do this. Can we listen to motivational podcasts? Absolutely, Riyaji. That's something you should be doing because that completely makes you wonderful. And now quickly, other steps. There is something called the BVM, breathing, visualizing. So breathing is basically when you are taking deep breaths, you're trying to calm yourself. So that this is a BVM formula I'm going to tell you. So breathing, visualizing. This is something on which people can talk upon for hours and hours and hours. But this is something every day, whatever is your major goal. So let's say for a student, the major goal is to excel in academics. Murali ji, I'll try to answer all these questions just after the 5 minutes. So that I can complete this thing, please don't mind. I hope you all understand. I'll definitely answer all your questions. Okay, I'll give you good hints also. Okay, so the point I was trying to make is visualization. All the successful people, when I talked about Ray Kroc, 55, how did he keep himself engaged till the age of 55? Every day he used to read a book called The Power of Positive Thinking. A lot of people buy this book, but strangely, they don't read this book. He always used to read this book for continuously 20 years and just see in the 55th year, he could bring the transformation. And today, McDonald's is one of the largest consuming brands we all talk about across the globe, 131 places, 131 countries, I believe. And that's the sort of reach McDonald's has. So the second thing is you have to visualize. Every time you feel someone is telling you, oh, come on, you cannot grow, you look weak, you're going to die soon. You have to visualize every day in the morning. Yes, The Power of Subconscious Mind is a wonderful book by Joseph Murphy. I've read this thing almost 5-6 years back, and that has also helped me out. So you have to visualize that everything is going to happen good. Everything is fine. Everything is good. Because that particularly helped me out also. The stage at which, no doubt, my parents could always fund me at that point of time. Strangely, they got to know about this situation after 4 years only when I disclosed that I was there into a situation where I just had 500 bucks. But then I kept on affirming, visualizing that no matter what happens, if others can do this thing, even I can do this thing. I'll definitely answer, Charanji, all your answers. I just need to complete this thing and then I'll quickly take all your questions. The next thing is you have to be proactive rather than reactive. The point is, the moment someone says something, we completely lose our mind. Oh my God, how did you say such thing? We never try to put ourselves into other shoes. And then we start debating. That debate turns into an argument. And that argument is completely affecting our mental diet. So instead of being reactive, you have to take a pause. Life is not going anywhere. We all are going to survive most likely till the age of 80. So we have a lot of time, my dear friends. So you have to take a pause before you get something devastating, before you get some negative news. Take a pause, because a decision in haste is going to result in regret and later. You're going to regret it later. So don't take your decisions in haste. And there's something important that you need to have a mentor, because in today's negative world, it's very important that we get some mentor who can actually guide us, who can make us go through all these things. You need to understand that there are various sources of digital mentors these days with the advent of technology, YouTube, webinars like these. You are getting a lot of mentors. An average millionaire has 7 mentors in his life. Mentors right from academics to positivity to every other thing. So you need to have a mentor in your life. And I'm truly honored, and you guys are truly blessed to have such wonderful mentors who are even attending this session, the wonderful faculty members you're having. So always have this curious mind. Instead of gossiping about who killed Jessica, talk to your mentors about how can I improve myself? What should I read into this subject? I want to become absolutely perfect in this subject. What should I be doing this thing? This is the work of a mentor who's going to guide you how to do a particular things. You have to practice the art of discipline. And you know what is discipline? Discipline is when you try to do something when you even don't feel like doing it. That's actually discipline. On good days, everyone is disciplined. It's only in the tiring days when you have to be disciplined. When Usain Bolt was asked into an interview, Usain Bolt, you are one of the fastest runners everywhere. And once the interviewer actually went backstage to see how these people are practicing, they were completely shocked. Usain Bolt was running for 8 hours. The interviewer actually asked them, asked him that, sir, you look so cool on the field, but and that looks so real, but then why are you struggling so hard behind the back? He answered, sir, you said you want to take the interview of my real life. This is my real life. The 10 seconds you see on the screen when I'm winning is a result of what I'm doing behind that screen. And that's particularly, my dear friends, specifically the young people who are attending this session, I need to tell you, we all watch TV, but this, at this age, when you are really young, I don't think so this is the right age to continuously binge watch a lot of TV. Why? The next moment you go and watch TV, and let's say you see Shah Rukh Khan, let's say you see some celebrity, let's say you see Bill Gates, the second moment you have to ask yourself on which side of the screen you really need to be. If you want to stay on the same side where you are watching, then you are always going to keep on watching and consuming that thing. But if you really want to be on the other side of that idiot box, I call it idiot box, a lot of people call it idiot box. If you really want to be on the other side of idiot box, shut down that screen and start working upon your goals, feeding your mind with anything to everything which is required. Here's an interesting fact a lot of people don't know. If you read 5 books of the best authors in your field, I repeat, if you read 5 books of the best authors in your field, you'll be automatically ahead of 95% of the people in your field. Strangely, we all don't do that. We are ready to read comic books. We are ready to read WhatsApp messages, which contain that send this messages to 100 people and Baba Ji ki kripa hogi. That's perfectly fine. But then instead of reading all these things, don't you think if you devote your time in reading those 5 books in your particular field, you'll be so ahead in your life. It would be so enriching. And you'll be far ahead in your life. So that's one particular thing which you really need to do. And get rid of mental weight consciously. You consciously have to think, I am feeling tired out. Whenever I'm talking to some XYZ person, I feel drained. I should stop talking to that person, no matter how good friend he is of mine. I should only talk to those people who inspire me, who force me to think more, who motivate me. That's exactly what you have to do. So now this is a plan by one of the famous doctors, Dr. AK. And he's not famous, that's me only. So here's the thing, step by step quickly, I'm going to tell you. Mornings are important, so make sure you don't ruin that by looking into negative stuff. Always, always, always focus on positive thing. Meditation, very underrated, very effective. Deep breathing is also a part of this thing. It has been proven that those people who meditate early in the morning for as little as 10 to 15 minutes, they are more productive, they are more conscious, they are actually achieving more goals in their life. And this is something which all the successful people do. You can add prayers to it also, because that also makes you feel good. Walk or workout. It has been scientifically proven that when you're walking or you're doing workout or when you're doing yoga for at least 20 minutes a day in the morning, it is going to release endorphins. For those people who don't know, yes, I'm not from a science background, let me be clear, so I cannot get into the nitty gritty, but endorphins are the good hormones which make you feel good, which eventually results into good productivity, good life. Next thing, pivot yourself to think positive. The world is negative. No one is going to come and feed you every day that you have to be positive, positive, positive. You have to pivot yourself. You have to prioritize what is important. Is it important to always have a fight with my friend, or it is important that I should be peaceful and I should start growing? You have to prioritize and start pivoting yourself back to this thing. Avoid talking to energy suckers. How many of you have observed that sometimes when you talk to some people, you feel so drained out that, oh my God, I'm feeling so devastated. But sometimes when you talk to some people, you feel so inspired. You feel like there's so much to life. Life is so beautiful. I need to do so many things. How many of you agree on this part? That's, yes, this happens. So guys, now consciously take benefit. I'm not saying break your ties. This is something I'll tell you from my experience. And young people, you need to understand. And I'm pretty sure. All the professors out here will agree with this thing. When we are young, we feel that we are all the hundreds of friends we are having. We are going to have all those friends in our entire life. But as you grow up, you realize you're going to be left away with hardly 5 or 10 people. How many of you agree, especially senior members who are attending this session, would agree to this part that yes, by the time we grow up, this is the same. So when ultimately you're going to be left up with only 5 to 10 people, why don't you pick them consciously that these are the ones with whom I really need to keep my bonds with, those who motivate me. Okay, I won't call them every day. but at least maybe once or twice in a month, I'll always speak to these people. At least I can send them a message. This way, you are going to keep yourself aligned towards the best possible outcomes, best possible goals. That's one thing. Read non-fiction. Non-fiction includes self-help books, scientific books, business books, something related to spirituality. Read more of these stuff. You can read fiction, Harry Potter and all that stuff. But I particularly would advocate read more of non-fiction. Three benefits for your mental diet. Your vocabulary will improve. Your thought process will improve, and eventually your life will improve. And finally, the most underrated thing, sleep well. We often are actually ignoring this part. You have to always sleep well. For adults, at least six and a half hours of sleep is required. For young people, somewhere around 7 hours is required if you want to have this thing. So mental diet comprises, you have to remove the 3C, you have to come out of crap, which means criticism, rejection, adversity, and prejudice. You have to ignore thinking about all these things. You have to have the halt. You have to consciously understand about these things. You have to read good things, speak good things, choose your company wisely, because you are an average of 5 people whom you hang around with. And this is, my dear friend, the perfect mental diet when you mix it with breathing, meditation, and workout. I hope you guys, you learned something out of this session. I would love to see some yeses over here in case you got something interactive. And then I'll quickly take up the questions, whatever questions you guys are actually having. And you can obviously ask me questions in Odia and Hindi also. I'm completely fine with that. And it's really inspirational. Thank you. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much. So I would request the moderator to please take charge from here, and then I can answer the questions, whatever I get. Oh yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a wonderful lecture. Right from BCD, scrap, halt, everything. Now, without wasting time, I request Dr. Acharya sir to please read the questions on the chat section. And those who are interested to ask questions directly to Srikar ji, they can also ask questions. But now it's over to Acharya sir to conduct this question and
session. Thank you, Dr. Pati. I invite Dr. Umakant Mishra, Associate Professor of History, to put his question.
Yes, thank you so much for a wonderful session. Am I audible? I believe I am audible.
Yes.
So I have put my questions in the chat box. Now, given the political climate which has turned society into a venomous organization, how will individual maintain its calmness or remain apolitical? It has to be a deeply political struggle, rather where obviously mental, physical, dietary calmness has to supplement. But you know, the larger issue of politics needs to be addressed by you, and this is my question now.
Okay, so I'll first answer this question. So no doubt this is something, and specifically we Indians are quite sensitive to all these political subjects, political debates, and all the sorts of questions which rise over here. Now here there are two things which we clearly have to understand at this point of time. Everyone has the fundamental right to have an opinion and view. There's nothing wrong about that. The Constitution itself gives us a right that we have the fundamental right to express our views, fundamental right to speak, fundamental right to put our opinions. But you know, the problem isn't about putting up the opinions. It's the way through which we are actually expressing these things. I know the way social media, the way television channels actually promote all these political agendas, that's actually not the right way. Journalism has gone out for a toss. Everyone is trying to commercialize these things. Everyone is trying to do so many things which makes it sensationalized. Now they have their purpose because they have to raise the TRPs for their organization. So that is where we have to consciously think that whatever we are consuming on the political front and political discussion, is it something wise? And whatever we are giving back, maybe in the form of tweets, maybe in the form of letters, maybe in the form of what we are talking with the society members, is it really logical? You would be surprised to know a lot of time when you consciously ask yourself whether this is going to have some good consequence, or I'm just speaking for the purpose of speaking, or I'm just putting up forefront my subject just because I want to talk about these things and this is something within me. You would realize when you consciously ask yourself first, rather than before questioning the person whom you want to question this thing, or maybe a media house, you will realize 80% of the times, most of the things which you are thinking, you yourself have the solution, and they are mostly on the negative front. So my solution on this front, if you are saying that yes, how we can actually cope up with these things, we don't get into this political dogma at that point of time, is plain and simple. Be very selective, first of all, be very selective. Second, ask yourself that all your political opinions or whatever you're receiving, is that somehow or the other going to affect your life and the people around you? Is it going to do this thing? If it is not, there's no point of engaging into that sort of discussion. Just take a leave out there. If it is going to affect, then think of what could be the best diplomatic way of putting it in front. Because, believe me, a problem with a lot of people is they openly just, you know, for example, if you have a political opinion and someone is not agreeing with that and you are into a group of 10 people, when you suddenly become angry and you bash that person, this has psychologically been proven that you should be criticizing in private and you should be appreciating in public. So when you're criticizing in public, what happens is the mind thought is now shut down. The other person will not be ready to listen to your political opinion. And the only thing he's going to do is kind of rebuke you, kind of defending his statement, and kind of, you know, always struggling to put his point front. Instead of that, if you go into calm demeanor and you put that point as if, okay, I feel that so-and-so party should have done so-and-so, this. And then what do you think about it? Then it becomes a discussion. The problem with most of us is we all hold opinions and we are really open to discussions. We should be open to discussions. So sir, first, don't watch a lot of crap news channels. I don't want to name any of those things which are having a lot of political agenda. Be a little specific. With observation, you will realize which one are purely giving you the right value. And instead of going more on the television media, I would insist, because they sensationalize more, you should actually read more of the news rather than watch it. I hope this thing I've answered your question.
Yes, one more question. It has been asked by Murli Sharma.
Okay.
The question is, how would you assess the significance of the fine arts and the performing arts in refining your young minds and helping them remain positive?
Oh, that's a wonderful question, I would say, that has been asked by Mr. Murli Sharma ji. So Murli ji has asked that what could be the significance of fine arts and the performing arts. Now, believe me, everyone, we all are into a rat race. Okay. Everyone is competing against something. Everyone is into a job or something. We don't realize that right from our cultural heritage to our history, even when Lord Krishna, okay, I'm not adding the spiritual angle, but this is the reality. Even when Lord Shri Krishna was studying his subject, he was even going through these fine arts and performing arts. How many of you know this thing? That yes, he used to go this way. I believe a lot of you must be knowing this thing. You need to understand that as and on we are progressing and we are adopting the Western culture, we sadly, unfortunately, have started taking all the other subjects quite lightly. I would tell you that when you are actually taking up fine arts or performing arts, or even the students who are working in these fields, this actually helps your brains to evolve. Why? Let's understand. Our brain is actually divided into two parts, right hemisphere and left hemisphere. I won't get into the nitty-gritty of all these things, but one is the logical side, one is the creative side. If you are giving a lot of balance on the logical side, only mathematical studies, only puzzles, then you're obviously ignoring on the other side. So it's very important, in my opinion, that you need to have this thing. In fact, Steve Jobs, the founder of Apple, he always advocated. In fact, you'll be surprised to know a lot of people might think that he formed Apple, the most valuable company in the world. So he must be a very profound engineer. On the contrary, he was a fine arts guy. Just imagine the biggest technology company being started. No doubt he had later on engineering degree and all, but he was actually a dropout, to be honest. So he was a fine arts guy. He used to have hand, what do we call, calligraphy. If I'm not wrong, the handwriting part is called calligraphy. He used to go and attend the classes of calligraphy. He had a profound impact of visualization. it actually works. Absolutely, it actually helps you to silence your mind, and the more silent your mind is, the more creative you will be. So yes, this is important.
Thank you. And one more question that has been asked by Ria Pine. What is the distinction between visualizing and dreaming?
Okay. Now, this is a vast topic, Riyaji, but in a nutshell, I'll just explain. Visualization is basically when you're consciously taking efforts to think upon your a practical goal which you want to attain in the next 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, or in your entire life, where you're actually either going to a meditative state or sleep. So just 30 minutes before your sleep, 15 minutes before your sleep, it is being said that you shouldn't watch horror movies, you shouldn't watch action movies. The reason is, okay, Sahuji, I'm glad to, I'll answer Sahuji, okay? I can see the chat now, okay? So when I talk about visualization, when you actually go to sleep, when you're actually going to sleep, 20 minutes before that, you actually slowly start drifting towards your theta state. Now, this theta state is the state where you actually have to imbibe good things in your brain. If you're actually imbibing only negative things, if you're talking about what people are gossiping around me, what they are saying, what the news channels are saying, you're actually doing the wrong thing, or you're watching horror movies, because then you won't get a quality sleep. So visualization is something which you need to practice over there. So in a small sentence, if you say, visualization is a conscious effort where you push your brain to think only positive, think good things, think about your goals, specifically done in the morning and evening, and dream is a larger goal. One form of dreaming is the scientific thing. When you sleep, you get a lot of dreams. Other thing is hold on to a bigger dream. It would be a larger goal or larger visions. For example, your dream could be to, you know, become the best philanthropist of the world. So now that's a dream. Now your visualization should be something like that. Every year I earn XYZ amount of money so that I'll be able to fulfill the purpose of that philanthropy. Because plain and simple, it's so easy. Money is not everything. You should do philanthropy. You should do charity. My question is, if you don't have money in your own pocket, how are you going to do charity? Plain and simple. You need to have this thing at least in 21st century. That's my thinking.
Thank you. And I think I should read out the question of, that has been asked by Tanmaya Sahu. Yes, his question is, I saw your interview. He is addressing you. I am just reading it out. I saw your interview with Mr. Bajaj on Face to Face. Then I have been exploring your Twitter for a while now and have found quality content on investing and trading. How do I go about investments as a whole?
So thank you so much, Tanmayji, that you have seen prior my interviews with Mr. Bajaj. I'm really honored. I think so that has got close to 1.6 lakh views, if I'm not wrong. It was a little controversial because of the chair I was sitting upon, because that was how the hotel actually promoted. But anyways, I'll directly come to your point. How to go about investments in hold? See, being a fund manager, being a trader and investor myself and a consultant, I do realize that investing is a vast subject. There is a reason why Warren Buffett used to study 300 pages of financial literacy every day. Because when you're getting into investments, there are two, three things you need to keep in mind. First of all, you need to have great knowledge about economics, statistics, maths to some extent. The basic maths is something that you need. And of course, the macro microeconomics plus the stock markets. One way to do this thing, I'll give you two suggestions of books. If you seriously want to become a good investor, these are the only two books you really need to look upon. First is The Intelligent Investor by Benjamin Graham. A lot of people won't understand this book. This is specifically for those who want to get into investing. And the second is again The Security Analysis by Benjamin Graham. If you are able to read this book again and again and again, concepts of investing will get clear. That's the first step. Second step, what you need to do. Second step, keep at par of what is happening into the business industry. Start reading a lot of news related to business. What exactly is happening? What merger and acquisition? What stake dilution is happening? Second. And third, understand the various accounting principles which are required. So even if you're from a non-finance background, it's not that tough. E-PDFs are available everywhere. You can definitely do that. So these two, three things as a whole you should do. And since you mentioned you are on Twitter, let me make you a word of caution. This world of technology, it is common for all. The world of technology has gifted us with Facebook, Twitter, and so many resources, but you have to consciously take your efforts, because 90% of the things you are getting over there also is crap. Someone is talking negative, someone is building conspiracy. So you being on the social media platform has to consciously take effort what to take and what not to, because sometimes you don't realize and you're consuming a lot of bad things. Instead of that, just look into promising positive and subject-based things over all these platforms. That is going to help you. Watch for good videos instead of violent videos, because this is something which is going to help you out. So this way you can go for this thing. I hope I have answered. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Sir, with the permission of our chair, sir, should I ask one more question?
Sure, go ahead.
Two, three questions are there, sir. One student is also asking. Please take up the question.
Yes, yes. Tanushree Mishra, she has asked a very relevant question.
Okay.
And good afternoon, sir. Thank you for the beautiful session. Sir, how to react or cope up with this, with societal negativity, which really affects our mindset? That is, what would people say?
This is one common problem which I'm pretty sure a lot of people would say. There's a Hindi kahawat, you guys can actually understand, sabse bada rog kya kahenge log, and this is something which has infected the minds of a lot of people, and it's everywhere. You go to any educated family also, with good academicians over there also, you will find, oh my god, what will the society think if you don't do this thing, what would you, I'm pretty sure a lot of must have faced this thing. Here's the answer to this thing, Tanushree. There's something called creative thinking. I'll give you an example. When I left my job, okay, which was a risky thing to do, because I come from a traditional conventional family in which the ideal route to success is you study well, you land up with a job and progress there. I told my parents after 6 months, if I'm not wrong, that I left my job. It was eventually, even they were a little scared, because business is something which is uncertain. A lot of people haven't seen. I didn't even tell them initially that I've left the job. There was a stage where I was just having 500 bucks in my pocket. It was eventually when I started gifting my parents with cell phone, watch, the iPad and all these things, they realized that, okay, now the son is comfortable. Maybe he's doing pretty decent since he's not asking money from us. So you need to understand, we Indians actually stay in a society where we're bound to face. So if I say completely ignore, that's not possible. That's a textbook theory. We will face all these things, specifically female members in our society. I need to admit, even though we say that now female are getting due weightage in our society, let's face it that they're still not getting the due recognition which they are capable of getting. So you are going to face this thing, what the people are going to say. You have to be creative. So what I did is, when I had faith on this thing, I'm not saying everyone should leave their jobs, okay? I'm not saying that thing. That was my way. My creative way was, first, let me prove something to my parents so that they feel comfortable, and then they will be able to take my opinion. The problem is, in our society, we have very less number of examples which our parents or the society has seen succeeding by going through an unconventional path. So first, slowly you have to be creative and get into unconventional path. That day, one of my cousins actually asked, he's very interested into music. He's also from Odisha, currently studying in Bhubaneswar. So he actually asked me, he's so keen in getting into the field of music, but then his parents are always after him that he particularly should only focus on engineering. For that, he actually was very tensed. He actually called me up, and being elder brother, he just asked me what to do. I simply said, you have to satisfy both the entities. How badly you need it, you need to understand. The society in our culture won't understand if you simply say, I want to leave everything and go into music. If you really want to get into this music world and your parents want to be an engineer, there's a way out. You want to become a sound engineer? You can go for a sound engineering. You go to US after your engineering. There are institutes which can provide you. See, I'm completely forward towards my culture, but this is something which was into his favor. That's why I suggested. I said, work so hard so that you land up into United States with an MS at that point of time. He's in the first year at this point of time. You can land up over there. You can get into sound engineering and music engineering. Your parents will be happy because you're doing engineering from a reputed institute. Plus, you will be able to stick to your passion and ultimately show the society how good as a musician and a sound engineer you have. Another quick example, Tanushree, for a normal person. So let's take an example. You want to do something, but your parents are not willing to do this thing. I wouldn't say directly hurting them is a good option. Think a little creative. How you can manage to please them as well. Each one of us a different story, and then do this thing. Ray Kroc, when at the age of 55 he wanted to go for McDonald's, his wife was completely against this concept. There's a wonderful movie called The Founder. The Founder. Everyone should watch this. That's entirely about the story of McDonald's. So there, he also, his wife, his society were like, at this age, who starts a business? But somehow he creatively used to find this way. In the morning, he used to sell vending machines to various restaurants. And in the evening, he used to start working part-time on this thing. So if you badly need something, same goes with Marie Kondo. Her entire family was against sports, boxing, female boxing. Come on, no one can go for this. She somehow summoned courage. In the morning, early at 4 o'clock, she used to take bus from her village, go and just practice, come back. Her father didn't know. Once her father also got to know, she was she somehow managed both the parties and finally became an inspiration for all. So if you need something badly, you have to make certain sacrifice. It could be monetary, it could be some a sacrifice of time, it could be some sacrifice of health at times. You have to do that. Yeah,
thank you, sir. Then another question is by Ananta Prasad Chakravarti. How one person with so many anxiety could defend his points to control his emotion from crowd, to control his emotion from crowd, because this can definitely disturb his mind.
Okay, okay. Can you please repeat what was the question?
How one person with so many anxiety could defend his points to control his emotion from crowd?
Okay. So here is a plain and simple thing, Anantaji, you need to understand that this anxiety thing, why does it comes into in is basically anxiety, the byproduct becomes something bad called cortisol, and that is the negative hormone which has been secreted, and we go into different this thing. So first of all, we have to prepare ourselves. Understand this thing very clearly. Okay. Preparation is something which leads to mastery. The problem is right now when you're putting up your point in front of someone, you're not mentally prepared about the consequences you're going to face. Now, here are two situations you need to face. First, let's say you have a viewpoint to make, but you're scared what the other people will think, what my family members will say, what my faculty members would say. Now you're only, and then you put up a point and suddenly all these things backfire and then you're completely gone. You get into the cycle of anxiety. Now here's the second situation. Second situation, let's say you are going to put front a point. Think of all the possible pros, cons and consequences of the opinions which can come. And believe me, our minds are very creative. They can think of n number of ways. So, okay, if I say that bananas are not good for health, my father might say, no, you are wrong. Scientific explanation. My mother might say this. My father would say. So now since you know what they can say, you have to be prepared. Okay, but what if I say that banana is not good for me? It might be good for others. So this way, when you're actually constantly asking yourself, you can get rid of this thing. Second thing you need to understand, after you put front your point, okay, and then you feel that how can I actually defend this point? You know, there could be a lot of calamities, clashes, because the person who's answering is actually a senior guy. I cannot put this point in front of this thing. Even before you put this thing, do this practice. And believe me, this is going to help you out. Even before you put this thing, close your eyes. For just 2 minutes, okay, just 2 minutes, think what you have to speak, take deep breaths during that point of time. What this will do is, even before you put this point, your mind waves will come down. So even if someone is actually attacking you at this point of time, you won't immediately get baffled. You have time to face all these things. This happens with me. I'll give you a very simple example. I put up my opinion on various social media platforms. On various social media platforms, I've got close to 2 lakh followers, includes YouTube, Quora, and Twitter. On Twitter, I've got 75,000 odd plus people. Now, just imagine a person with 75,000 plus people following him over Twitter. It's pretty evident that I have almost 50 to 100 people talking negative, talking bad about me, talking pessimistic. Always they are envious people, they are jealous people, and all these people. Now, what do I do at this point of time? Some of them make some random stories. Some of them make conspiracies. Some of them make a lot of things. Recently, also, I got to know some people are talking bad about me. Now, I have 2 options. One is to be reactive. I talk about being proactive versus reactive. One, I can react. How come you can say this thing? People have been making various videos on Twitter about me that this person is this person. So one is reactive. Another one is I have to think. First, I'll put my opinion because it may not help all the 100 people, but it might help 10 people. So I've thought of those 10 people. That's why I'll put my point over there. But second, Will focusing and answering all those negative queries ever satisfy those people? No, because people just have opinions. They are not open to discussion. Believe me, my friends, most of the people, if they want to prove that what they are saying is correct, no matter even if Lord Brahma comes down to earth, they cannot prove that they are wrong. This is a normal human tendency. So you have to be flexible, plain and simple. You have to take deliberate effort to calm yourself before you put your point. And second, after you put your point, before even that, you have to find all the consequences and prepare yourself before. And after that also, sometimes you might get something abrupt out there. But then that's a part of life. Slowly, slowly, once you start practicing this habit, you will be into a better position.
Thank you. And last question, it has been asked by Pradosh Acharya.
Okay.
Do you think environment has a role on mind?
Oh, absolutely. The environment within which you stay has a lot of effect on your mental diet. I'll give you 2-3 simple examples. You would see that most people who were born with riches, so for example, I wouldn't name, so there is a famous billionaire who is now running away from various CBI agencies and policemen for the last 2-3 years. He was a lavish person over here. I'm pretty sure a lot of you must have guessed him, right? The aviation king, the king of good times, as they say. So now what has happened is his son was always born with a golden spoon. His son never knew what is the power of struggle, why it is important to make yourself multidisciplinary, why it is important to do your things by yourself. And today at this stage, when his father has been considered as a sort of criminal at this point of time, he can't think of creative ways to get out of that zone. And he has completely made his life useless at this point of time. Why? Because he was born into an environment where he has not seen hardship and he has not seen struggle. On the contrary, when you talk about all these gentlemen, Radhakishan Damani, who started DMart, he was also from my field, a fund manager and a trader and an investor. Same goes with Ratan Tata. If you see Ratan Tata, you would see how humble these people are on the screen. They don't have an ounce of ego on their head that, yes, I'm so and so. They don't even feel like telling the media that, so I'm so rich person, you should treat me so well. They will wear a normal shirt, normal trouser. Mark Zuckerberg wears the same t-shirt for almost 365 days. And here we normal people always want to wear almost 10 to 20 t-shirts. I'm not saying to wear that dirty t-shirt always, but I'm just giving an example for perspective. So my dear friend, environment does affect. And that's one of the reasons why I said you have to consciously take efforts in understanding what you read. You have to read good things. What you listen, you have to listen good things. What you speak, you have to speak good things, positive things, optimistic things. And the people with whom you speak, you have to consciously judge. If you're talking to people who only drag you into a negative zone, my dear friend, consciously alert that no matter what happens, I'm not going to pick up the phone. And that is certainly what I've done in the past few years. I had hundreds of friends. My parents used to be pissed off because of that, because every time I used to hang around with some or the other friend, slowly I realized it's a waste of time. And now my friend circle, okay, I have good acquaintance, but my friend circle has thinned down to like 8 or 10 people. And one more important thing, your environment plays an important role. Always try to get a company of someone who's smarter than you. Of the 5 people, at least 3 should be smarter, more intelligent than you. Why? Because they inspire you to reach to that level. If everyone is below your level, then you become Andho Mein Kaana Raja. It makes no sense. So in my circle, I have one person from Delhi. My parents also know, they have heard about him. So that person is someone who's worth hundreds of crores, okay, at this point of time. So wealth-wise. Then I have a person in my circle who is a great academician in my respective field, who knows all these things. I often try to talk to those people. Then there's one person who's really good with digital marketing and all those fields. He's younger to me, but I don't mind taking lessons from him. So he calls me his mentor, but I also get to learn a lot of things from him. So your environment plays a lot of important role. In fact, the place at which you are working also plays an important role. If your place where you're working is very chaotic, a lot of noise, a lot of disruption, just go and pack yourself into a room where no one can disturb you, because that's how you can focus. It is scientifically proven, if you're working towards a goal or a project, and if you get a distraction even for 2 minutes, it could be a cell phone call, it could be anything, for you to get that attention back, it takes at least 15 minutes. Just imagine, 2 minutes break and 15 minutes thing. So first get into a focused state, work on an environment, keep it clean, keep it tidy, keep good things around you. You can see behind me, these are my books, which I keep on reading whenever I get time. So I plan to build up my own big library also. So you have to, your environment does this thing. And if your environment is not conducive, make it conducive, make it in your favor or shift. That's how you have to stay.
Sir, thank you so much for replying to all the queries. But just now, a very interesting question has come to my notice, and that question has been put by our deputy registrar.
Oh, I'll be honored to answer that. Sure.
Morning people are positive, evening people are sharp. What is your view on this?
I'll tell you. So while I was actually researching on this habits of sleeping and all these things, I was also trying to find out what is so common. So there's this guy, Robin Sharma, who has written a wonderful book called 5 a.m. Club, where he has interviewed the most successful people. And on an average, he found that most, if not all, of the successful people in all the fields, be it science, be it fashion, be it celebrities, even for those people who don't know, Akshay Kumar for the last 25 years sleeps at 9 o'clock and wakes up at 4:30. Just imagine the movies of whom we actually enjoy, that himself, that person doesn't go to party, but we love to dance on his party songs. So it has been proven scientifically that morning people are not just positive, they are sharp. I'll take you through a simple example. Everyone, and I believe all the professors, esteemed panel would agree to this thing. Historically, even in our Vedas, it has been mentioned, the reason why students or the learners are actually asked to wake up early in the morning, because our retention power is high in the morning. There is no noise. That's the most important thing. We are living in a chaotic environment. Every time there are sounds coming over here, morning is so peaceful that you can actually complete the most important task easily. I get more productive, and oftentimes I used to, now even my parents have understood, I used to yell at them if they were disturbing me in the morning, because this is something which I feel is the most productive. So I think we cannot generalize that sharpness as well as this thing has to do something with evening. Yes, night owls have been performing well, but if you ask my view, someone who wakes up early, who has a good diet, so there in mental diet, you have to keep in mind, you have to think positive, you don't have to see negative things in the evening, only then this is actually possible. So you have to wake up early. That's my view. That will make you creative, make you sharp, and make you more smart. And evening people, I would say, don't go too late, because I was reading a scientific study which clearly mentioned that when you're sleeping after 11:30, you're slowly exposing your brain cells towards death. And the rate at which your brain cells actually die actually intensifies if you're sleeping after 11:30. We all take it casually until unless we suffer from Alzheimer at an old age. So it's very important that we start taking all these little things carefully. So sir, my answer is plain and simple. Morning is always better in our culture, in our Vedas, in our teachers, in our faculty members. Everyone has particularly said the same thing, which we actually do this thing. I hope I have answered this thing.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Now I request our deputy registrar to carry on the session.
Thank you, Ajaya sir. Thank you. But I put that question, but I took the inputs from our scientist, Vice Chancellor, sir.
So, okay, Vice Chancellor, sir. Adhis, so, yeah.
Question is basically aspect of Vice Chancellor. So, thank you, Abhishek Karji. We are really grateful to you for sparing your available time, almost 2 hour session now. And you made it highly interactive. A lot of students have also asked their questions. Our faculties, invited guests, they have interacted with you. A lot of questions and appreciations have got for this. So thank you very much. We are also thankful to Shyama Acharya sir for conducting the question answer session so nicely. Now I request our honorable registrar sir, Sri Girish Chandra Singh, is here.
Thank you, esteemed Vice Chancellor sir, respected Chief Speaker Vijay, Sri Abhishek Karji, respected our heads of the department Hindi and also commerce, and deputy registers and invited guests, students and media persons joining this webinar. We are thankful to our Abhishek Kaurji for sparing his valuable times and for his wonderful lectures. Thank you, sir, for inviting our invitations. Our stakeholders must have get motivated from your speech. Thank you, sir. We are thankful to our Vice Chancellor, sir, for being the leader of this institution and creating this type of opportunity for all the all the stakeholders of the university. A note of appreciation for everyone who have joined in this program. Thank you, everybody. Have a good day.
Thank you, sir. Now it is time for the national anthem. So I request all of you to please stand up for the national anthem. After that, officially our Vice Chancellor sir will declare the closure of the meeting. So, System Manager Ashish Patel.
जन गण मन अधिनायक जय हिंद भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ पुत्र बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
So we are thankful to our technical team for providing all the technical support in making this program successful. So thank you, everyone. Now at this time, I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor sir to officially declare the closure of the meeting.
On behalf of Gangadhar Nair University, we are very much grateful to Mr. Abhishek sir, and thank you very much, sir. And I also appreciate the participation by so many faculty and students of our university and some invited guests, and they have interacted with the speaker and in a very wonderful manner, and this speech of Srikar has been extraordinary, very fabulous and inspiring for my students. Thank you very much. And I formally now declare closure of this webinar. Thank you very much.